We are the Unalaska team, the HASA, and our project is reducing carbon emissions through geothermal energy to mitigate climate change. My name is Shane Morris, and I will start off with the introduction and melting sea ice as well as Arctic implementation and its problem causes. After that, Glenn Lucia will discuss ocean acidification with its problems and causes, as well as the effects on fisheries and the ecosystem. Next, Shelby Shaitikov will talk about our mitigation plan, introducing geothermal energy as our solution. And finally, Jerome Teo will end with our local mitigation with the Unalaska Nikushin Geothermal Plan, as well as what we can see for the future. A problem for Alaska and the globe overall is Arctic amplification. Arctic amplification is the change in the net radiation as it has a larger temperature change at the poles compared to the planetary average. This can cause sea ice to melt and with factors such as sunlight exposure, warming waters, and polar jet streams. Melting sea ice is a result of climate change, and a leading cause of this is the abundant amount of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. As CO2 levels increase, greenhouse gases become more common, causing the ice to melt with a recession of about 10% every 10 years. One of the things that can cause sea ice to melt is sunlight exposure. Comparing sunlight exposure from today to several decades ago, we can see many differences. As sea ice melts, more water is exposed, and with the waters having darker contrast, more heat is absorbed by the water and ice, with less and less albedo. This in turn will cause surrounding ice to melt and waters to form. With the direct sunlight of water, we see this paradoxical effect of melting sea ice around, causing even more sunlight exposure, further melting sea ice around. And when the sea ice melts, we see this accumulation of a large amount of cold water condensed that will downwell in the Arctic and form this cold blob at the bottom of the Arctic Ocean. This can cause marine organisms such as crustaceans to relocate their habitat. Another thing that can affect sea ice is polar vortexes and jet streams. Polar vortexes is an area of low pressure and cold air. Melting sea ice can harm the networks of these patterns of jet streams. Jet streams are fast and narrow air currents that strengthen during the winter and get weaker in the summer. As sea ice starts to melt, these jet streams start to become weaker and more warm air starts to move north with colder air moving south. With the irregular weather patterns, this can further damage the melting sea ice and many other organisms in the area.
Ocean acidification is an excessive amount of carbon dioxide, also known as CO2, in the atmosphere. The ocean has a natural pH level of 8 and usually absorbs about 30% of the CO2 in the atmosphere. With elevation of atmospheric and oceanic CO2, this can lead to a decline of seawater levels, pH levels. For over 100 to 200 years, scientists observed the ocean has increased 30% in acidity level than it was before, and they have predicted that at the end of the century, the ocean will be 150% more acidic than it is right now. So the CO2 buildup had increased rapidly during the Industrial Revolution, where many factories and machines were created. CO2 buildup occurs when considerable amounts of fossil fuels, natural gas and oil, are burned, along with land use exchange. The highlighted factors of ocean acidification are transportation vehicles and factories as human population continues to increase. High ocean acidity levels are caused when CO2 mixes with seawater, which develops hydrogen ions. An increased amount of hydrogen ions can reduce carbonate ions. Now, carbonate ions are important for structural properties for calcifying organisms, such as corals, seashells, sea urchins, and many more. Without carbonate ions, these organisms would have a difficult time maintaining their way of life. And without concrete protection, predators can have easy access on these creatures. It is important to maintain balance within the ecosystem for rapid increasement and decreasement of species can plummet the food web. This could cause an economic depression as fishery products decreases, causing an increase of prices. Negative impact on fishery production can take a toll on Alaska, for the state produces about 60% of the nation's seafood supply, with the charter being securing the top spot as a supplier. Seafood industry's flooding can lead to unemployment of up to 58,700 people and an economic decline in Alaska, so it is vital to maintain these organisms. So globally, over a billion people rely on seafood, especially coastal communities, where most rely on the ocean for economic growth. Food chain, not just in the ocean, could be affected too, considering many non-marine organisms, such as marlins and birds, rely on some, if not most, of these seafood for their diet. Loss of corals and crustaceans have a very negative impact on the economy and ecosystem, for without them, economic factors such as tourism, jobs, seafood supply, and many more would decline. And without corals and shells, organisms will be unable to have a stable home. In addition to that, organisms will also have limitations on their growth, reproduction, and survival. But this is because they use additional energy, to maintain themselves internally, such as their acid-base balance, their metabolic processes, and biological functions. With all these problems in hand, here is our mitigation plan presented by Shelby Shashnikov.
Our mitigation plan indirectly solves previously mentioned problems through renewable energy, such as geothermal energy. Geothermal energy is the thermal energy of the earth. Power plants of this nature utilize the heat that circulates in the earth. And as you may know, the further down you go, the more the heat intensifies and the more the pressure builds up. This heat is exchanged and produced by radioactive decay of minerals. And as the groundwater heats up, it expands as it reaches the surface. The construction of these sites begins with drilling. Usually industrial oil drills are used to drill 4 to 9 kilometers into the earth. And these sites are usually built near volcanoes and hot springs, geothermal sites, and it takes 2 years to construct and transport turbines for these sites. The methods of production are dry steam, flash steam, and binary cycle. Dry steam power plants drill into the earth to the groundwater, and that water wells up and produces steam that powers the turbine, and the turbine powers the generator, conducting electricity. Flash steam power plants, the water goes into the flash tank and flashes into steam and powers the turbine, and this water is then injected into the injection well, repeating the cycle. The binary cycle power plant, the water comes up and it goes through the heat exchanger, in which it heats another secondary liquid that has a lower boiling point than water that powers the turbine faster than all of the other processes, and this is the most used cycle. The cost of geothermal plants vary depending on how deep you drill into the earth. For example, the Geysers Field power plant, their first 900 to 4,000 feet was $40,000 per well, and they built multiple wells, which was quite costly. And the majority of these costs come from drilling, as I said, and the cost of the turbines. The downsides to geothermal energy is tremors that are usually less than what you'd experience in a small earthquake on a regular basis. These sites are location dependent, usually near volcanoes or hot springs that are on national parks, which might be hard to get to. These sites release certain gases that may be harmful to agricultural sites, but these gases can easily be captured. The energy benefits of geothermal power is there are zero carbon emissions from the process, making this a source that could be part of the solution in making our planet a healthier place. The production of electricity will power anti-pollution devices, and the wastewater can be injected to the site to provide more water. These plants do not require a boiler as the heat of the earth accesses it, and do not require complicated electrical systems, reducing the cost. Hydrogen fuel could be made by the excess electricity. Hydrogen fuel is made by electrolysis, in which water and hydrogen bonds are separated using electricity, and it produces hydrogen fuel cells that can fuel cell engines and hydrogen combustion engines. Another process is heat pumps, in which the heat transfers into either the outdoor cell or the indoor cell by coils into a refrigerant. And depending on whether you want like a heater or an AC, the evaporator and condenser switches between the coils. There are many geothermal sites in the world, such as the Tuscany site and the Iceland site. These maps show potential geothermal sites which revolve around the Ring of Fire. And I think if we created more sites, we would be able to reduce our carbon footprint overall.
Currently, Unalaska is constructing a geothermal power plant on the local volcano, Mount Kushan. The project itself is set to finish in 2024, and during our research, we had the opportunity to interview John Zachers. He is a PhD in geothermal energy and is the chief scientist and chief engineer for the Kushan project, during which he stated that people of Unalaska have been wanting geothermal energy for 40 years, and with about 400 references, this is indeed possible. The plan is to mitigate climate change through geothermal energy. The processing plants, the leaders in carbon emissions on the island, will alternatively use geothermal energy to power their facilities. The goal is to have total sustainability on the island. The power plant itself is a 30 megawatt an hour power plant. It will produce 250 million kilowatts of energy per year. This is more than the city of Unalaska needs. So where does this excess energy go? Well, Dr. Ziakos also stated multiple ways to use this excess energy, such as greenhouses, heat pumps, electrical car batteries, and hydrogen fuel. In conclusion, we see that geothermal energy is useful in the long run. It is a profitable and sustainable energy that can tackle climate change. Additionally, we can create jobs for Alaskan engineers throughout the state, pulling engineers from the specialties electrical, renewable energy, civil, and mechanical. From this, we will lessen the impact to our fisheries, my hometown, and the world. And although this is a small step towards total sustainability in the world, it is a step. And as we progress technologically and industrially, it is only a matter of time before we see more climate solutions. And geothermal energy could be that answer. This is our bibliography, and thank you. We can take questions now.
I have a question. looking at your presentation, you talked a lot about the exchange of heat. So in your turbine designs, in the third one, you had a system which is called common current exchange. It was two tubes run water next to each other, but don't actually switch water between them. Where in the natural environment or in an organism might you find this system?
Can you repeat that question?
Yeah, sorry. So in your turbine design, there's heat transfer between the steam coming out of the ground, right? It comes around, and then the design you said was the most efficient one. The steam comes in, comes down, and then another tube from the turbine comes down next to it, and they're in contact, but the steam doesn't actually go between them. Where might you see a similar system in the environment?
I'm sorry, but that was outside our scope of research. That was a great question, and I will learn more about it.
Nice job, guys. So my question is, you're drilling up fluid from the earth, and it gets redeposited back down into the earth, right? Is there any toxic waste involved in that water? I'm just curious because, I mean, this energy source does seem super efficient, really low impact, but I'm curious, is there anything added to it while it's on the surface, or is it just deposited back down into the earth and everything is fine?
When it's converted into steam, when it flashes into steam, there can be harmful chemicals such as boron and other chemicals that can harm the growth of small fish. Most of the time they can be contained, but that can happen. Also, when we do inject wastewater in, that can also release any toxic air pollutants. So.
Great, you totally answered my question. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so this is really cool. You showed that there's like more volcanoes like all along the Pacific Ocean. So does something like this require a lot of people to maintain it? Or could it be put in places less populated and that energy be moved to a more populated place that doesn't have the same source like a volcano?
One of the cool things about geothermal energy is it's a non-intermittent power source, which means that it doesn't require any sort of energy things that run off of irregular time intervals. So solar energy relies on it can be affected by cloud coverage, or wind could be like wind turbines can be affected by like the wind speed. Geothermal energy can run 24/7 and it has little to no maintenance. Most of the work that gets put into it is just constructing the plant itself. Otherwise it runs almost on its own and it doesn't really need that much maintenance.
Thank you.
For the United States, about 0.4% of all energy produced is geothermal energy, which is about 2% of renewable energy. It has the potential to take up 10% of all energy produced in the United States if we were to access all the easy to access hotspots of volcanoes. And it has the potential to take up about 25% of the world's power demands.
All right, any other questions?
Yes, they are they're easier and less expensive to construct. They're about the 2/3 of the price of a nuclear engineering plant, or just a nuclear plant. They are cheaper to make, but they can take longer to construct because you have to get the turbine out and you have to drill. And we just wanted to point out that most of the cost was from drilling and the turbine. Other than that, they are relatively cheap.
You were mentioning some downsides to using geothermal energy, and you mentioned gases that are byproduct of using it. What are some of those gases that are byproducts?
One is boron. It can be harmful to agricultural farming. Another one, I can't remember the name, but it can affect the growth of small fish.
We're done. We gotta be done. Thank you very much. Let's give them a round of applause.